Got the bulletin. Greg brought me one. The 12th is a ladies' meeting. That's 2 weeks away, and then the men's meeting is the 14th. That's the two things I was trying to remember. Don't forget that the school meeting is what we call it, Soldiers Training for Service, the last weekend in April. Not this coming Sunday is Easter. The next Sunday after Easter would be what, about the 15th? Then there'll be about the 21st, and then there'll be the weekend for the men's meeting. So there's really, after this Sunday, there'll be two more Sundays before the men's meeting. We need to have, it won't be Easter Sunday, I'll announce it Sunday. The Sunday before would be April the 20th, along in there, or the 21st, whatever that weekend is, 22nd. April the 22nd, that Sunday afternoon, we need to have a meeting of everybody at Shorewood who's a part of Grace School of the Bible. Those of you that are students, you've been students and that kind of thing, I'd like to meet with you. Well, maybe we'll just eat lunch together. I'll get lunch together and us have a meeting together in order to kind of make some arrangements and some plans for the weekend meeting coming after that. By the way, we also have that weekend, there's going to be for young people, they're calling it a purity conference. It's a conference for single young people about dating and living in the world, the culture we live in. How can you raise godly children in an ungodly age like we live in? Well, that's an issue that young people have faced from time immemorial because the world's always been ungodly. But they're going to have a whole program Friday night. They'll be in the meeting. It'll start about 5 o'clock for them earlier. They'll meet back in the teen room. Then they'll be here in this meeting in our general meeting for the evening. Then all day Saturday there're going to be some special meetings for them, running parallel with the other things we do. And they'll be a part of the evening meetings with everybody else. But it's be geared just especially for them. And there's going to be 15-20. High school, college age young people here. And if you're a part of that, the people on the internet want to, you plan to bring their young people with them, they're certainly welcome to come. Anybody that that's coming for the meeting needs to contact us if you need housing. If you don't need housing, you don't have to contact us. But if you let us know you're coming, it kind of helps for the food services and all. We feed everybody on Saturday, breakfast and lunch, and then breakfast on Sunday, so it helps a little bit to know the general amount of people are going to be here. But if you need housing at the hotel over here, you have to be sure that you register with Debbie ahead of time so that we have a room for you. Okay. All right. John chapter number 16. I'm sorry. John 16. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for your love to us in Christ Jesus. We thank you for the provisions that your grace has made, and that allows us to have some fellowship with you around the things that delight your heart. And we pray as we look at this passage tonight about the ministry of the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit in our lives and the lives of others, that it might encourage us to see your provisions, and we rejoice in it in Christ's name. Amen. Now we're down to verse number 12, John 16, verse 12. Let me just reiterate what I said to you last week about verse 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11. Those are probably, if not the most abused text in the book of John, one of them, would be one of the top three passages in John that is uniformly abused. And another one would, of course, be John 14 about in my Father's house are many mansions and that kind of thing. But this passage, that passage in John 14, if you misunderstand it, it won't really damage your Christian life on a daily basis. This passage can. Because this passage in John 16, verse 8, 9, 10, and 11 is generally used as the basis for the idea that the Spirit of God works apart from His Word in the hearts of people and in the hearts of the world to try to bring them to Christ. And I tried to say to you last time, this passage is not talking about a subjective working of the Spirit of God out there in the inner conscience and in the inner thinking of people apart from His Word. Rather, this passage is talking about, Jesus is talking to his apostles about I'm going to go away, and the Holy Spirit is going to come, and he's going to come and be in the world just as real a presence as Christ himself was. It's talking about, here's the impact that the coming of the Spirit of God is going to have on the world. It's going to be an objective impact. Here's the effect. When he's here, he's going to reprove the world of sin because they believe not on me. His presence is going to demonstrate the unbelief of the world. Why? Because Christ, he said, the Holy Spirit can't come unless I go away. Why does he go away? They send him away as a royal exile. They don't want him. So the fact that he belongs here, he's the rightful king that should reign here. The fact that he's not, that the Father has said to him, come and sit thou at my right hand until I make your foes your footstool, he's on exile. Well, why? Well, the presence of the Holy Spirit is an objective demonstration of the world's unbelief, of righteousness, because I go to my Father. The Holy Spirit is here because Christ goes to the Father and the Father is glorified. Chapter 7, we've looked at that passage extensively. He says the Holy Spirit can't come until Christ is glorified. And that's why in Acts 2:33, Peter says that the reason what you see here on the day of Pentecost is Christ went to the Father, received the promise of the Father, and has poured it out. And it's a demonstration of the Father's endorsement of his Son and of judgment, because the prince of this world is cast out. There's nothing ahead for this world except judgment, because Satan has been defeated. And the Holy Spirit's presence is an objective historical demonstration of all of that. Now you come to verse, and I remind you that because when you come to verse 12, you don't want to slip back into, or you don't want to have been in this thinking about all this stuff working with the Holy Spirit is this kind of unconscious, subjective, inner working that just sort of focuses on your feelings and the impressions and your gut hunches. That isn't what any of this is about. Verse 12, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I, that he shall take of mine, and shall show it unto you. Now that's a passage where Christ is talking about the ministry of the Holy Spirit among the little flock as after he goes away. That's what this whole section has been talking about. When he says in verse 12, I have yet many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them. You remember what he said back in verse 6, verse 5? But now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you asketh me, whither goest thou? But because that I have said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. They're so caught up and filled and absorbed and gripped by their own grief, by their own interest, by their own calamity, by their own loss, that they can't see into spiritual things. They can't see beyond their own circumstances at the moment. And Christ says, you know, I've got some things that I need to tell you. I've got more for you to learn than what you know right now. But right now, ye cannot bear it. You can't bear them. Bear it now. Verse 16, he says, a little while, and you shall not see me. And again, a little while, and you shall see me, because I go to the Father. Then said some of the disciples among themselves, how is this that he saith, a little while, you shall not see me, and again, a little while, you shall see me, and because I go to my Father. And they said, therefore, what is this that he saith, a little while? We cannot tell what he saith. See, when he just begins to tell them about his, I'm going to go die. You're not going to see me for a while. Tomorrow, I'm going to die. Then I'm going to come back, be resurrected. They don't even get that. Now, that's one of those, this is one of these texts that demonstrates to you that they're not sitting there thinking, well, tomorrow he's going to go die on the cross for our sins and then be raised again for our justification. This is one of these verses that tells you very clearly they don't understand what later is revealed to Paul about the gospel of the grace of God, about how Christ died for our sins, was buried, and raised again the third day for our justification. They're gospel preachers. In fact, two days after his resurrection, he'll send them out to preach the gospel of the kingdom, which they'd been preaching for 3 years, and yet they don't know some of these things. And he says to them, I've got, there's more for you to know, but you can't bear it right now. You can't get it. So I'm going to give it to you, but you're going to have to get it later. You see, they thought Christ was going to stay with them forever. They didn't understand that he was fixing to die. If you go back to chapter 12, verse 34, 12:34, the people answered him, and what he says to them, verse 32, 12:32, and I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. This he said, signifying what death he should die. And the people answered him, we have heard out of the law that Christ abideth forever. And how sayest thou, the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? They thought he was going to stay there with them forever. Well, the abiding forever isn't a reference to his first coming. It's a reference to his second coming. When he's talking about his death, he's talking about his first. But they don't get that. They don't get all that. So there's a whole bunch of stuff they aren't getting. And he says, you're not able to bear it, but you need to understand that you're going to get it. Look over at Luke chapter 24. On the day of the resurrection, in Luke 24, he meets with them that Sunday evening in the upper room. And Luke 24, verse 40, just verse 44 would be all right. Luke 24, 44, and he said unto them, and he's in the midst with his disciples here. If you go back to verse 36, and they thus spake, we'll start back in verse 33. And they arose up that same hour and returned to Jerusalem, that's the two on the road to Emmaus, and found the 11 gathered together and them that were with them. So what they do is they go back to Jerusalem and they find the 11 and those that are with them in the upper room. Verse 36, and as they thus spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said unto them, peace be unto you. And they were terrified and affrighted, and supposed that they'd seen a spirit. They thought a spook showed up. Because they got the doors locked, the windows all nailed down, and there's too many people. All of a sudden, there he is. They were not expecting this, okay? So he shows himself to them, verse 44, and he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. And then he opened their understanding that they might understand the Scripture and said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. So in the Scripture, he could show them that he was going to die, be buried, and be raised again the third day. And in Acts 3:18, when Peter says, all those things which you spoke before, that the Scripture said Christ would do, he hath so fulfilled everything the Scripture said. But they weren't able to get these things here in John 16. But after the resurrection, he opens their eyes that they might understand. So he's going to give them further knowledge and information. But if you come back to 16, he's going to tell you something about what that further knowledge and information is going to be about. John 16, verse 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, and that'll be Pentecost and after that, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath given me, all things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I, he shall take of mine and show it unto you. So here's the process. God the Father has some things he gives to Christ. Christ takes those things, gives them to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit takes them and gives them to the apostles. So what the apostles get from the Holy Spirit aren't the ideas and things about the Holy Spirit. They're the things about Christ. He's going to glorify him. He's going to give you my thing, the stuff about me. But the stuff about me isn't mine. It's the stuff the Father gave me. That's why all along in John, Jesus is always pointing to my meat is to do the will of him that sent me. Everything I'm doing is to do the will of my Father. He never points to himself. He always points to himself as the servant of his Father. Now, you know he's God, and equal with the Father and the Son, the Holy Spirit, they're all three members of the Godhead. But there's a functionality. There's a role, a role-playing that they're doing. There is a relationship in the Trinity where each member of the Trinity lives to serve the other members of the Trinity. That's what divine life, God's life, is all about. So when the Spirit comes, he's going to function the same way Christ functioned. So if Christ is living in you and the Spirit of Christ is living in you, how is he going to function in you? The Spirit's going to honor Christ. Christ's going to honor the Father. They're all going to work together. Now, verse 13 is a fascinating verse because it's actually the fourth time through here he's reminded them that the Holy Spirit's the one who's going to reveal the truth to them. And again, this revealing of truth, when he says, he will guide you into all truth, he's not talking about putting some inner impression down into your heart to say, now that's the way to truth. That's not the truth. This is the truth. There's not the truth. Now that's what preachers preach it. That the way you know God's will is because you get this impression in your heart, you know. God kind of gives you this nudge and sends you over there to do something. And that's not what he's talking. He's not talking about the Holy Spirit guiding your decision-making process through an internal subjective means. When he says he's going to guide you in the truth, all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. What do you speak when you speak? And what do you hear when you hear? Words? Would that be it? You don't hear an impression. You don't speak a feeling. You speak words. You hear words. Now, one of the things that this verse is important, why that's important, you see how he says, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you. This is a great verse to demonstrate the personality of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is indeed a person. He's not an influence. He's not an attitude. People say there's a sweet spirit in here tonight. I mean, it's just there's a nice atmosphere kind of thing. I think it's the stupidest thing in the world to go to church to get, if you just want to feel good, going to church is a dumb place to go. I mean, the seats aren't even comfortable. These are pretty good, but, after an hour and a half, they get a little hard. If you just want to feel good, go down to the Charlie's Pub down here. That'd make you know you can feel good down there. That's not what you go to church for. You'll be entertained. Well, you know, go to movies. That isn't the purpose of church. I know that's the way people operate it. But the Spirit of God is not a it's not a feeling. It's not a sensation. People said there's that song, there's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. You know, we just all feel love. Let's have a big electronic hug. And that's wonderful, but, you know, like I said, go down to Joe's and you can find that down there. That's not God, the Holy Spirit. The Spirit, it's not an attitude. He's a person. And when you read about the Spirit of God, you're not reading about a feeling. You're not reading about something attacking your emotions. You're reading about the activity of a person. He will guide you. He shall not speak. Notice he can talk. People talk. I know you talk to Buster. Does Buster talk back? He whines. A typical guy, I know. Acts chapter number 8. He's a typical guy. He just whines. So what do you think about the stock market today? Did he tell you how he thought about that? No, he didn't do that. He didn't care. Yeah. You understand, people talk. And I was talking to Dawn about her dog. If Dawn talks to the dog, you know how she talks to the dog? She gets down to the dog's level. The dog didn't come up to her level. So I worry about people that talk to their dogs, see? I know, I say. She would if it wasn't being recorded. So that's why I picked on her. But the idea, if he can speak, that's a trait of personality, of personhood. Acts chapter number 8, verse number 29. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go now and join thyself to the chariot, to this chariot. Notice the Holy Spirit speaks, he talks, and he talks to Philip, holds an intelligent conversation that Philip can relate to, gives him instructions. Chapter 13, Acts 13, verse number 2. And as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. Now, you wouldn't read that and not get the idea that the Holy Spirit is a person giving instructions, commandments to be obeyed. He's got a plan. He's got a calling. He knows what he's doing. He's working the plan. Chapter 16, Acts 16. Verse number 6. Now when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. Notice here, he makes a decision that you can't go over there. He's observing, he's making choices, and he's giving instruction. He's a person. Come on to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Verse number 10. I'll start in verse 9. 1 Corinthians 2, 9. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man, the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us. How? By his Spirit. Well, how did he do that? For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of a man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God in the Bible is a person who has intelligence, knowledge, the ability to communicate that in a spoken word. In fact, the very first time you see the Spirit of God in the Bible, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And the next verse, and he said, let there be light. The very first thing you find in the Bible about the Spirit of God is that He's a person. He's not an influence. He's not some abstract kind of attitude thing. He is a person who has wisdom, knowledge, and the ability to communicate that with other people. Come with me to Ephesians chapter 4. Just to kind of tie the rag on the bush. Ephesians 4, verse number 30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Notice the Holy Spirit not only has intellect and knowledge, not only does He speak, but He also has feelings. He can feel. An influence doesn't feel. An attitude projects feelings, but here's a person. So one of the things you want to notice back here in John 16 is that this is a great text to demonstrate the fact that the Holy Spirit is a person, but there's something more than that if you go back to chapter 16, verse 13. Howbeit when He, the Spirit of truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth. For He shall not speak of Himself. He's a person, can communicate, can tell you the truth. He can bring you into that truth. But whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak. Now watch. And He will show you things to come. Now that's an interesting thought. Because the ability to make predictive prophecy, foreknowledge, that is a distinctive character of God alone. Come back with me to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter number 42, verse number 8 and 9. Isaiah 42, verse 8. I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Behold, the former things are come to pass, and new things do I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. God says, I have the capacity to tell you things to come. Predict the future, tell you what's going to happen in the future. And that's something that I have, and I don't give that glory to anybody else. Come back to chapter 41. He's already told them that. Chapter 41, verse 21. 41:21. You'll recall Isaiah 41 through about 48. Isaiah is chiding. God, through Isaiah, is chiding the nation Israel for going after other religions, other gods. When they had Him, they had the truth. And so He says to all these other religions, all these other gods, verse 21, produce your cause, saith the Lord. Bring forth your strong reasons, saith the King of Jacob. I've always been struck by Isaiah 1:18. When He first starts talking to Israel back in Isaiah 1, He says, come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. God Himself is willing to lay out the logical rationale for believing Him. That's why when Paul says, be not conformed to this world, be transformed, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. If you think it out accurately, you'll find there's no other conclusion to come to than to do what He said. So when God is faced with all of these other gods and the multicultural world People think we live in a unique era. The multiculturalism of our day, the egalitarianism, the post-modernity that they love to, I love that word. I just like to say it. You know, it sounds so stupid. We live in this post-Christian world and all this business. Like, none of this ever happened before. And I'm thinking, if you went out here and stood on a street corner in downtown Chicago, I did about 2 months ago, and spent a half hour passing out tracts on a street corner down on Michigan Avenue, and I do that every now and then just for the refresher course. Because you know what you find out? You'll find out that Genesis 3 is where people live today. 50 years ago, I used to stand on a street corner in Mobile, Alabama, and pass out tracts, and you know where people were living 50 years ago in Mobile, Alabama? Genesis chapter 3. It really hadn't, all the stuff going around it's changed, but the real issues haven't. So the Lord says, let's get to the real issue here. Produce your cause. Bring forth your strong reasons. Let them bring forth, verse 22, and show us that which shall happen. I mean, if you're God, you ought to be able to tell the future. Let them show the former things, what they be, that we may consider them and know the latter end of them, and declare unto us things for to come. Show the things that they are that are to come hereafter, that we may know that ye be gods. Yea, do good or do evil, whatever you want to do, that we may be dismayed and behold it together. If you're God, you can tell us things to come and be accurate about it. You see, that's a characteristic of deity. Well, Jesus takes that characteristic of God alone and says, you know, the Spirit of Truth, when He comes, He's going to do what only God can do. So not only does this passage help you understand the Holy Spirit as a person, it helps you understand that the Holy Spirit is a divine person. He's one of the members of the Godhead. He's part of what we describe as the Trinity. Come with me, if you will, to Acts chapter 5. That's why when Peter is dealing with Ananias and Sapphira in Acts 5, verse number 1, but a certain man named Ananias and with Sapphira his wife sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the feet of the apostles, at the apostles' feet, I'm sorry. Then Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? And why, and to keep back part of the price of the land? Whilst it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thy power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto who? God. But who did he say he lied to in verse 3? The Holy Spirit. The Apostle Peter is not averse to saying, you lied to the Holy Spirit, why did you lie to God? Because in the Scripture, he would understand, and he would understood from John 14, verse 13, that the Holy Spirit was one member of the Godhead. And so that when he lied to the Spirit of God, he was lying to God himself. So, I'm not going to belabor the point, but the point is that, I tell you what, go back to Isaiah 48. I will belabor this point. Might as well. I've said to you before, this thing about the Trinity, each member of the Godhead working together in harmony. That great story back with David and his three mighty men And when the scripture says they went as one, and each member of the Godhead working together, each member of the Godhead works together in the incarnation of Christ and the death of Christ and the resurrection of Christ, all working in harmony. That's the idea of the Trinity. The idea of the Trinity is not that there are three gods. There's only one God. That is, just like we said, there's one humanity. There's only one essence and being of deity. But there are three people who possess that essence, that eternal, infinite essence of deity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we call them. And we give them those three titles because those three titles are titles of relationships within the Godhead. Because that's God wants you to understand that the way He lives is in relationship. He's not a God sitting off on a stump by Himself like Allah, who is isolated. You know, if someone is isolated, you don't know whether you can talk to them or not. You don't know whether they want to talk to anybody or not. You know, I was in a store today, and I was doing some things, and I wasn't paying attention to what was going on around me. And I came up to the counter, and the guy at the counter asked me, you know, he told me how much the bill was, and I gave him a credit card. And my mind was off on something else. And he's trying to have a conversation with me. And I wasn't responding. I didn't even hear him. I don't know what he said. Cynthia kicks me in the knee. She says, "You're not paying attention to the guy. He's talking to you." I said, "Oh, okay." Well, pretty soon he didn't think I wanted to talk to him. And you know what? He was right. I didn't. I had something else on my mind. But you know, if somebody's kind of standoffish, you don't know whether you can talk to them or not, whether they won't talk to you or not. But if they come out and give you a glad hand, a smile, start talking to you. You ever get on an elevator with somebody? I used to love to go around with Nick Trzyski. Brother Nick, he's in heaven now, but Brother Nick, we would go somewhere and get on an elevator, and he'd just start talking to everybody. People get on an elevator. You know, Nick would just start talking. And he said to him, "I like to talk to people on an elevator. I don't like standing there, nobody talking." And he just had, you know, Nick, he had a gift of gab. He could just start talking, and nobody thought he was fixing to assault them or get in their way. They just enjoyed talking to him. Some of us don't have that ability. But you know, you like to have a conversation. Well, see, the Godhead is not, it's not one God sitting off over there, one individual sitting off over there who, and by the way, if you're isolated, you know what? You don't have a lot of social skills necessary to deal with other people. But boy, if you're in relationship, and the Trinity means God lives in relationship. That's why it's called the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, those terms of relationship. When we study through Ephesians chapter 1, you're going to see each one of those relationships functioning. But they all work. The old timers, there's a word for this in theology, and it means the dance. And there's an old theological concept called the dance of deity, and it's not talking about doing the ragtime jitterbug or the Macarena or something. It's talking about each member of the Godhead working in harmony and flowing to the rhythm of what they're doing together. And it's an ancient idea. It goes back into the early days of Christianity. And the idea is that's what the Trinity is. So when you recognize the idea of God the Holy Spirit being a part of that, and Jesus said He's going to receive this truth the Father gave me and I give to Him, and what He gives to you will be what He got from me, and what He got from me is what I got from the Father, and we're all working together in this. Just two verses about the Trinity. People sometimes say the Trinity is not found in the Old Testament. And people say, well, he says, let us make man and so forth. And you can argue, you know, that's an indication there's somebody there that he's talking to. And you can say, well, this is other members of the Godhead. Somebody else will say, well, but there's other people around there than then. You know, and he just said, you watch me do it. People gainsay those things. But here's a passage that really isn't a gainsaying passage. Isaiah 48, verse number 16. Isaiah 48, verse 16. Come ye near unto me. Now the one that's talking is Jehovah, verse 12. Hearken unto me, O Jacob and Israel, my called. I am he. I am the first. I also am the last. In Revelation chapter 1, the Lord Jesus Christ identifies himself as the first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending. And he's referring back to a verse like this. So the person that's talking here is going to be God the Son, the second member of the Godhead, the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 16, come ye near unto me, hear ye this, I have not spoken in secret from the beginning. From the time that it was, there I am. And now the Lord God and his Spirit hath sent me. Thus saith the Lord thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord thy God, which teacheth thee to profit. Now notice there are three people here. You notice at the end of verse 16 where it says the Lord God, you see how those two words are spelled? The word Lord is a first cap, then lowercase O-R-D. And then you see God is all in uppercase letters. Now in a King James Bible, when you see the word Lord in all uppercase letters, look at verse 17. I am the Lord thy God. You see that word Lord there is all caps. When you see that word Lord in all caps, what does that tell you? It's the word Jehovah. That's the English, behind the English word there is the Hebrew word Jehovah. Well, when you see in verse 16 that word God in uppercase, that's what it's telling you there too. So in verse 16, when it says God, uppercase G-O-D, that's Jehovah. But when it said Lord, first caps, then lowercase L-O-R-D, the Lord God, that word Lord there is Adonai, the Hebrew word for Adonai, Jehovah. Every time you see that construction, Lord God, with that kind of capitalization, that tells you that what the Hebrew text is saying, it's Adonai Jehovah. That is always God the Father. Okay? One of the identifying marks in your Bible, when you say Adonai Jehovah, you're talking about the first person of the Godhead. Verse 17, when it says capital L-O-R-D, all caps, thy God, that's Jehovah Elohim. Most of the time the word God is a translation of the word Elohim. So in verse 17, when it says Lord God, Jehovah Elohim, that will always be God the Son, the second person of the Godhead. Follow that? There they all three are right there. There's the Lord God, Adonai Jehovah, God the Father. There's his Spirit, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of truth. And then there's Jehovah Elohim, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, one of the reasons that's important is because that helps you to see. Look over at chapter 61, verse number 1. The Spirit, capital S, of the Lord God, of Adonai Jehovah, of God the Father, is upon me, that's the Lord Jesus Christ. There is God the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the Father, sent by the Father to anoint the Lord Jesus Christ. You see that in Matthew chapter 3. God the Father speaks from heaven, the Holy Spirit comes down and anoints the Lord Jesus Christ. There's the Son, there's the Spirit, there's the Father. If you go back with me to Genesis chapter number 3, I'll make it chapter 2. Genesis 2, verse number 4. These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. In the day that Jehovah Elohim, but who is Jehovah Elohim? That's Jesus Christ. Who made the heaven and the earth? Jehovah Elohim, the Lord Jesus Christ. John chapter 1, he says, without him was not anything made. He made all things, and without him was not anything made that was made. Now look down at verse number 7. And the Lord God, Jehovah Elohim, formed man. Who is it that made man out of the dust of the earth? Second person of the Godhead. Verse number 8. And Jehovah Elohim, the Lord God, planted the garden. Verse number 16, and the Lord God, Jehovah Elohim, commanded man, saying, verse 18, and the Lord God, Jehovah, see, who is it that's creating Adam, dealing with Adam, educating Adam, communicating with Adam? Jesus Christ is the spokesman of the Godhead. He's the manifest person of the Godhead. So when you come down to chapter 3, verse 8, and they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. You see, Adam literally had fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ, the second member of the Godhead, in the garden. Jesus Christ is always the one who's the daysman, the go-between, the mediator. Now come with me to 1 John chapter 5. I say that to you just so that you can see how that sometimes those things are, you know, they can be tremendous blessings to you. But in the Old Testament, all three members of the Godhead are there. They're not all functioning in the ultimate role that they have. Under the old covenant, the Holy Spirit's ministry, he would come, do things, and go back home. They didn't have a permanent ministry. There were many things he didn't do. He didn't regenerate people. He didn't do a bunch of things because those were new covenant ministry things. Now Jesus is talking to him about what he's going to do with the new covenant. And they're going to kick the thing into high gear. One other verse, 1 John chapter 5, verse number 7. I mentioned Brother Nick Trzyski a while ago. Nick and Helen, when they first came to Shorewood many years ago, they came through a ministry that had, in fact, they'd gotten kicked out of a ministry over this verse. They understood the Bible version issue. They understood the Bible text, the King James issue, as opposed to the modern translations. They understood that. And you know how Nick and Helen, Nick was always sort of he had the ability to appear innocent when he was being very outspoken. And He would, you know, he just had that ability to walk up and ask questions of people. And he never embarrassed about it, is what I'm talking about. He was just always had that boldness. Helen has that boldness too. And valiant for the truth. And when they learned about the Bible issue, they took it home with them. And they were going to a church on the south side, down close to where they lived in Brookfield. And Nick noticed, Helen noticed, that in the doctrinal statement where it had a statement about God being a Trinity, that it didn't have this verse in it, 1 John 5:7. This is the great Trinitarian verse in the Bible. So Nick went to the preacher there and asked about why it wasn't there, and long and short of it was they got put in the road. That's how Helen got out of that's how they got out of the Catholic Church. Helen went down to the school where her kids were going and objected in the Catholic school to them teaching evolution. And when she found out that the priest believed in evolution, well, then that was enough for her. You know, might not know everything, but I know I don't belong here. And this was the same way with this verse. I say that to say this: you watch doctrinal statements. That's one of the things I watch, is you pick up somebody's doctrinal statement and you look at the statement about God and about the Trinity, and you'll be shocked how often this verse doesn't appear. This is the clearest, most profound verse in Scripture about the Trinity, but it's left out of all the new Bibles. It exists in the received text. It's in the Bibles that our ancestors have used back, that you can find them all the way back to the 6th century. In versions and translations that people are using all over Europe, all over Asia, I'm sorry, Africa. But the modern critical text leaves it out. And so the folklore is it shouldn't be there. But look at this verse, 1 John 5, verse 7. And there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. Now, if you didn't want to believe in a Trinity, that'd be a verse you wouldn't want in your Bible, because that verse pretty well nails it, ties the rag to the bush for you. So that's a verse people like to leave out. And I show it to you just so that you can know where it is and know that if somebody's leaving it out, that they shouldn't leave it out. The point being, it's time to quit. Go back to John 16, verse 13. Howbeit, when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will guide you into all truth, for He shall not speak of Himself, but whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak, and He will show you things to come. First, understand He's a person. Two, He's God. He can do what only God can do. He can show you things to come. But as the Spirit of truth, what is truth? Jesus in the next chapter says, sanctify them by thy truth. Thy word is truth. He's the Spirit who is going to write the word of truth, and a part of what He's going to do when He writes the word of truth is show you things to come. What Jesus is doing here is literally, He is giving a pre-authorization for the writing of the New Testament. And we'll see that next time. Okay? All right. Whoop-de-doo. For my Subaru, which I don't have. Okay? It's good to see you tonight. We'll just pray and we'll wait on the kids. Father, we thank You tonight for Your goodness and Your grace to us in Christ Jesus. We thank You for Your living presence, for Your life, that You so desired to share with us, that You were willing to love us with a love that wouldn't let sin ruin it. We thank You for that in Christ's name. Amen. All right.